but we can also review these mechanisms from time to time. Thank you for your response. I'll bring this agenda item to a close. I thank the SFC and the FSTB. Next, agenda item number 5, budget of the Accounting and Financial Reporting Council for the financial year of 2024-25 and proposed funding injection. Let's invite the administration and the Accounting and Financial Reporting Council, AFRC, to join us. With us today are Mr. Joseph Chen, Undersecretary for Financial Services and the Treasury, Mr. Keith Zhang, Deputy Secretary from the FSTB, Mr. Eric Lee, Principal Assistant Secretary of the FSTB, and we also have from the AFRC, Dr. Calvin Wong, Tin Yao, Chairman, Ms. Janie Lai, Chief Executive Officer of the AFRC, and Mr. Stuart John Roseman, Head of Finance and Administration from the AFRC. Let's welcome the FSTB and the AFRC. I'll now invite Dr. Calvin Wong, Chairman of the AFRC, to walk us through this agenda item, and then we'll also invite Mr. Joseph Chen from the FSTB to speak. Good morning, Chairman and other members. There are two parts to my walkthrough. First of all, I will brief members on the work progress and results of our work in 2023-24, after which I'll also walk through the our philosophy of work in 2024-25. Ms. Janie Lai will then walk members through the proposed funding injection of 2024-25. After the implementation of the new regime, we have enhanced our function. As an independent and full-fledged regulator of the accounting profession, we are responsible for the accounting sector and the regulation of public interest entities and certified public accountants. We are also responsible for supporting the development of the accounting sector. On supervision and regulation, despite our work on different fronts, the AFRC has been putting in place different assignments, well, I mean different initiatives, including education, professional guidelines, and these are for the reference of the sector. We also hold round table meetings, seminars, talks to remind investors the importance of prudence in terms of investment. Our principle is to solve the problem of accounting report quality at source. We want to encourage the relevant stakeholders to discharge their responsibilities. We've been promoting collaboration of different organizations, comparing notes, and protecting the interests of stakeholders and investors in order to enhance Hong Kong's status of international financial center. The AFRC has been practicing prudence in terms of finances. We also believe that this can help the management set different priorities, streamline processes, and improve operational efficiency. Since the 1st of October 2023, the AFRC has been collecting application fees for issuance of practicing certificates and registration of practice units. The AFRC also used the remaining balance to pay the relevant expenses. On the approved budget with the updated forecast, the forecast income for 2023-24 is $211.45 million, $52 million below the approved budget. Mainly, we needed more time to fill the vacancies. In 2024-25, our operating expenditure is estimated to be $244 million. Well, 64% and 36% of different functions. The Hong Kong economy is still subject to complex situations around the world. There is also a manpower crunch in the accounting sector. In 2024 to 25, we suggest maintaining the existing 145 positions. 93 and 52 accountants of PIE and non-PIE function. There's a budget deficit. The government has injected seed funds, which will be used up in the third quarter of 2024. The AFRC will continue to set the priorities within our realm, but will also tread cautiously in our finances. At the same time, the AFRC will also review our resource needs and will also study with the government new streams of income. We do want to sustain financial sustainability. Anything else to add? Mr. Joseph Chan, together with the AFRC, will brief members on the budget for the financial year 2024-25, as well as consult members on the proposed funding injection. The new accounting regulatory regime was put in place last year. The AFRC has enhanced its function. Expansion includes the regulation of practice units with and CPAs, including issuance of practicing certificates, registration of practice units, as well as inspection, investigation, and discipline of practice units and CPA. Owing to the user's pay principle, the AFRC has been charging levies to different CPAs and PIE CPAs. Registration fees are also paid to the AFRC. The government has injected a total of $400 million into the seed funds in order to provide further provisions to the AFRC in reporting the budget. There are different limits, and the seed funds will also be used up within this year. So we need to set a long-term financial regime. The government fully recognizes the work of the AFRC and will also monitor the financial resources and use of finances of the AFRC. The local economy is subject to a complicated or complex external environment. The accounting sector is also met with the existing manpower crunch in Hong Kong. In 2022, the new regulatory regime is still in its starting phases, so the time is not ripe for putting in place a proposal to solve the aforesaid problem. We recommend the injection of $200 million. We'd like to help the AFRC to rise above the challenges financially in order to maintain the existing regulatory level. In the meantime, the administration will continue to work with the AFRC, review its finances, and study any possible new income stream in order to maintain the financial sustainability of the AFRC. I'll now hand over the floor to the AFRC. I'll now invite Acting Chief Executive Officer Ms. Janie Lai. Good morning, Chairman. Good morning, members. Please be succinct. In 2024-25, I'd like to talk about the budget for this financial year. Mainly, the income is from PIE and non-PIE related functions. The total estimated income for 2024 to 2025 is $236 million, among which around $128 million is from levies for funding the PIE-related functions. In addition, we also assume that the levies income and fee income will remain unchanged. So PIE auditors and non-PIE auditors stand at some $33 million and $26 million respectively. We expect license fees income will total $44 million. We do not recommend any change or adjustment in the level of levies income and fee income. The total estimated operating expenditure is about $404 million. And manpower costs will account for 60%. In 2024 to 2025, our major work will include completing our manpower expansion plan. So, we do not have any proposal of increasing the establishment of the AFRC owing to the increasing risks of cybersecurity cases. We need to increase investments in cybersecurity, mainly on cyber facilities, risk management, and the development of programs, maintenance of systems, and so on. In 2024 to 2025, owing to the enhanced scope, for any legal fees and professional fees, we expect them to go up. The increase will be $30 million or so, accounting for some 8%. So the budget deficit will total $167 million. We are willing to take questions from members. The floor is now open for members to ask questions. 4 minutes, question and answer included. Mr. Chen Chenying, thank you, member. The enhanced function of AFRC is understandable, and we have seen losses all over the past few years. The requested injection is $200 million, and it will only last 1 year. Just now, Dr. Kelvin Wong and the Undersecretary said that they are working on a long-term sustainable proposal that can support the work of the AFRC financially. Well, the earlier the better, of course. Just now, we've heard from the SFC, the investment income per year is $130 million or so. $4 billion from the reserve. The AFRC will not be able to self-sustain given the current situation, but the government is right now in the red. Well, if the government were in the black, it would not be difficult to inject, for example, $1 billion or $2 billion into the AFRC. But at present, well, I think it is paramount for the AFRC and the FSTB to draw up some policies. I have two simple questions. For capital expenditure, there will be some expenditure to support technology, that is $12.4 million, to enhance cybersecurity. The amount is $245 billion. That is, it far outweighs the amount just now mentioned, and I'd like to know the reason behind it. Just now, it was mentioned some regional regulation forums will be held. Can you tell us more details about it? Is it a platform among AFRC in Hong Kong and the AFRC of different jurisdictions? Thank you, Mr. Chen, for your question. I'd like to first take the second question from Mr. Chen. Regarding the capital expenditure and the operating expenditure, I will defer to the acting chief executive officer. For the forums member mentioned, we do have the budget. Mainly through inviting local, overseas, and mainland financial regulators who mainly regulate auditors of listed companies. There are also securities regulators. We'd like to invite these professionals to an annual forum. In the forum, these professionals can exchange views on their regulation experience. They can compare notes. We did have a plan to roll out this forum, but owing to the epidemic, we could not put it into practice. But now the time is ripe for us to do so. The epidemic has subsided. In the fourth quarter of this year, we'd like to hold this forum. We can showcase to other jurisdictions the work of the AFRC. That is our work on the accounting sector and our regulation of the auditors of listed companies. So we have sufficient experience to learn from each other. We can compare notes and so on. There is also the second section of the forum. We'd like to invite the industry, not least the CPA of the accounting sectors. We'd like to invite them to join the sector so that they can foster exchanges. And this is our plan about the forum. Ms. Jenny Lai, first of all, on the expenditure on IT. At present, we are using a rather simple system. But owing to the increase in the number of cases almost doubled or even tripled, we do not want to rely on a simple system. At present, we are working on a rather comprehensive system. That is to enhance the synergetic effect among different departments. We also take into account security factors. We have a case management system allowing us to complement each other, hence the high cost this year.
Next, Mr. Chan Kin Po. Thank you, Chairman. The AFRC, like the paper says, is a comprehensive, fully-fledged independent regulatory body for CPAs, PIE, accountants, and so on, to make sure that the accountants are fulfilling their professional functions. Now, the establishment is 140 large. Since the establishment of the AFRC, what benefits have it brought to Hong Kong since so much money has been spent? What is the benefits for society as a whole and the accounting sector? Before this AFRC came about, the Hong Kong Institute of Certified Public Accountants was responsible for licensing and other issues. So we want to avoid misspending of public resources. We want to minimize the levies and fees on CPAs. So how much has the AFRC helped us save? Mr. Joseph Chen, thank you. In 2019, given the launch of the public interest entities accounting function, we injected $200 million into the AFRC as a seed fund. And then after the expansion of the regulatory regime, it began charging fees. So the government hasn't injected anything more than the seed capital of $400 million since 2019. The AFRC is an independent body to monitor CPAs and PIE accountants, as well as ensuring that it is in the rules are in alignment with market needs. Thank you. I appreciate this opportunity for us to state our mission again. In other international financial centers, the supervision on PIE accountants and CPAs are conducted by bodies other than their institutes. In the past, the monitoring function was conducted by the Hong Kong Institute of CPA, but it is not an entirely independent body. So according to other benchmarking bodies and rating agencies in the international community, Hong Kong has been criticized for not having our own independent monitoring regulatory body, without which the regulatory regime would not be transparent enough. So in 2019, the disciplinary power enjoyed by the Hong Kong Institute of CPA was transferred to the AFRC. So whether the regulation was performed by the previous institute or the AFRC, I can say with confidence that the expenditure of the AFRC for performing this function is similar to that of the Hong Kong Institute of CPA. And also, as an international financial center, faith in our system is important. Faith has to be built over the years, but it can be destroyed overnight. So we conducted an audit check on our PIE accountants' work performance. We are satisfied with their work quality. Their working quality is similar to PIE accountants working in major international financial centers in the world. Dr. Wendy Hong, this year the AFRC is applying for a 200 million non-recurrent funding to meet its expenditure next year. I support that. But how will the AFRC achieve financial balance in the future? There may not be any quick fix, but what about medium to long-term measures to increase revenue and cut expenditures? Can you give us a timeline? When will these measures be introduced? And as the chairman said, the AFRC took a longer than expected time to fill up its vacancies. However, in the market, there is lesser demand for accounting talents. So did that help? And also in the Hong Kong market, there is a weakened demand for IPOs. So have you taken into account that weakened demand in preparing this budget? Secretary, thank you. I will take the first question and I will hand the second question to Dr. Kelvin Wong. As I've mentioned in my opening remarks, we will continue to review with the AFRC on measures to open up revenue streams and cut expenditure to achieve the user's pay principle, as well as financial self-reliance. Over the past few years, there have been some difficulties because the new regulatory regime or the fee charging regime was only launched in December 2022. Before that, we were just using the seed capital to sustain the operation of the AFRC. And also, at the launch of the regime, we have waived the levies and fees for 1 year. That created some financial pressure as well. And we made a pledge that we would maintain the fee level as before after the launch of the new regulatory regime. So these are the challenges. We are seeking another $200 million to tie the AFRC through this fiscal year before we conduct another study, because we only have 1 year of implementation experience of the regime. We want to take tally of the experience gained as well as the markets of affordability to in considering the long-term arrangement. Concerning measures to save cost, I will defer to Dr. Calvin Wong. Thank you, Dr. Wendy Hung, for your questions. On recruitments, we do see more supply in the market because of the economic downturn. We have received more applications for our jobs, indeed. At the same time, the private market is in need of experienced accountants as well. To be honest, many of our experienced colleagues have returned to practice in the private sector. So there were ups and downs in terms of our manpower situation. 140 positions have been granted by the government, but we are only to fill 120 of them. The third question I would defer to Janie. Please be brief. Sorry. Third question about the decline in the IPO market, as well as the auditing quality of our accountants. Now, the audits we conducted didn't cover a wide range of sample, and it was not limited to the IPO sector. We are going to conduct an audit on other sectors as well. So the decline in IPO projects would not lessen our work burden. Thank you. Next, Mr. Edmund Wong. Thank you, Chairman. Four questions. Paragraph 10 says that Paragraph 20 says that there is no room to open up new income source in accordance with the user pay principle to address the aforementioned cash shortfall. So what feasible new income source is the AFRC considering? So our practicing license is one of the major revenue of the AFRC. And also, at the panel meeting, the government said that in the initial years after the transfer of licensing power, the AFRC will not charge the fee at a level higher than the previous level. So what do you mean by the initial years? How many years are you talking about? Now, for non-PIE auditors, the fee is usually $40 million. The revenue is usually $40 million a year. So under the user pay principle in the future, maybe you have to charge three times the amount as the present level. So I am worried that PIE auditors will not have any incentive to stay here in Hong Kong, where the regulatory regime is so harsh and the fee is so high. We have to think about the healthy developments of the industry. Third, the $400 million seed fund and the $200 million additional funding, how much of them will be spent on helping the long-term sustainable development of the accounting industry? Fourth, it is the industry's views that the AFRC is doing very well in terms of regulation. No matter how hard we try, we can't fly beneath the radar of the AFRC. But one of the AFRC's missions is to effectively regulate the markets and encourage a competitive market and promote development of the trade. Now, with such strong-handed regulation, how can the industry be benefited? Thank you. I will answer some of the questions, and then I will hand over to the AFRC to speak. On the user pay principle and also the seed money in 2019, the $400 million injection was for taking off the PIE auditor regulatory regime. In 2022, when the AFRC was given an extended function to regulate the registration of CPA, that was not covered by the seed money. So under or after the launch of the PIE regime, we also expanded the function again in 2022 to give it larger power to regulate CPAs. And that has only run for 1 year only. So we want to take tally of the experience gained in the past year after implementing the new regime and considering the affordability of the trade and the future developments of the accounting industry. We will study how to achieve the user pay principle in the future. So we will continue to report to our members and consult the trade when we have any new ideas. Concerning the long-term developments of the trade, first, the function of the AFRC is not just a regulatory one. It is also tasked to help the industry develop. As mentioned by the AFRC, they have been conducting forums and seminars for that purpose. A healthy regulatory regime can boost the international investing community's confidence in our system. Now, the membership of the board of the AFRC comprises members appointed by the government, and also the advisory council also comprises members from the government. Now, concerning the other questions, I would defer to the AFRC. Please be brief. Concerning the income and expenditure on PIE auditors, I would defer to Ms. Jenny Lai. Concerning the audit check on PIE, the expenditure was on the high side. However, we are receiving $5,000 from each PIE auditor for this exercise. So it is not a very huge financial burden for us. For 2023 or 2014, we have selected 13 PIE auditing firms for auditing. There will be some 30 PIE auditors involved. So the impact or the inconvenience is not that great. And also in the process of audit review, we have also offered a lot of useful advice to the PIE and non-PIE auditors. So improvements were made after the inspection. And also the breakdown, please. Can you give us a breakdown? So I thank Mr. Edmund Wong for your questions on how to balance regulation and promotion of the trade. And I thank Mr. Edmund Wong for recognizing our past work. I have a clarification to make. As a regulatory body, there is not a distinction between good or bad regulation. The purpose is to ensure healthy regulation, to ensure healthy development of the market. That's the job of the regulator. So there is no bad or good regulation. So we are taking concrete steps towards that direction. Since 2019, the AFRC has spent a lot of resources on policy study and guidance issuance for CPAs, as well as for board members of listed companies, as well as their auditing committees, so that they would comply with the requirements of the law. If listed companies are doing a good job in terms of financial reporting, then their auditors would have an easier time delivering good work. So that's why we have spared no efforts in educating and reaching out to the sector, including institutes as well as reputable associations of listed companies. On our website, we have uploaded a lot of our exchanges with these bodies as well as guidelines. Sorry, for the interest of time, I have to stop you. We have been overrunning. So these guidelines are very helpful for the trade. Thank you. Next, it is my turn. We appreciate the importance of the AFRC's task as well as its needs for funding. Well, in the previous items, we have mentioned many times that a stock market has been performing poorly and we need measures to revitalize the market. Now, the cost of stock transfer would involve fees are paid to the AFRC, the HAMA, as well as the HAEX and the SFC. So we need to achieve balance. Now, without adding to the course of the market, we have to enhance the competitiveness of our market. Now, the stamp duty on stock transfer has been dialed back to the 2021 level. However, from the perspective of the trade, we don't want extra burden on investors, either the buyers and the seller. So will there be any room to adjust the fees paid during stock transfer?
Thank you, Chair. As I said during my opening remarks, we would like to adopt a user-pays principle in the long run. In fact, to ensure financial viability of the AFRC, and in the long run, as I said earlier, we want to adopt the user pays principle. It's a matter of time. We will review the arrangements this year. We will consider a host of factors, including the stock market situation, including the operations of the accounting profession and whether they can afford such fees, as well as the external environment. Let me say this again.
once we have anything in mind, we will report this to the trade as well as LegCo members. Thank you. Ms. Carmen Khan, the last one to speak. Thank you. I do support the proposed fund injection. Let's be fair. The AFRC is a full-fledged independent regulator. This is very important to consolidate Hong Kong's status as an international financial center. It also regulates auditors and CPAs. CPAs are newly added. If we see, if we look at paragraphs 19 and 20, as well as 21, it would show the financial position of the AFRC. Right now, the market turnover is $99 billion per day. And it is said that the number of PIEs will be assumed to be the same. For the fee income, it is also said to remain unchanged. I do understand the difficulty faced by the AFRC in actually adopting the user pays principle. Right now, there is a gap in the headcount of approximately 20 odd people. Has the AFRC considered engaging their own expert witnesses, because that is quite a significant expense? Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Khan, for your questions. Regarding the 25 headcount to be increased, you said, would it be able to cover some sort of engagement of expert witnesses or external lawyers for the headcount? It is not viable because we would need to engage external lawyers and expert witnesses to support our decisions. Regarding your legal services division, what is their function? Well, they have helped us with a lot of things, but we need to engage external lawyers or external witnesses. Regarding whether we need to engage external lawyers and expert witnesses, it would mainly be the decision made by our external division. I can see here in the paper that the AFRC said they want to control costs. If they don't list out specifically the areas where they want to save costs, this seems to be just empty talk. This is just my observation. Thank you. Well, anything to add, Deputy Secretary? Thank you. Well, Undersecretary, please. Well, this is indeed the FSTB's view that AFRC should try to be prudent with their costs. Thank you. Well, as said, according to the paper, the government plans to inject funds to the AFRC to meet its expenditure in 2024-2025. Do members have any comments regarding this funding injection? If not, this is the end of this item. Thank you. Let's move on to agenda item number 6, proposed legislative amendments to implement the global minimum tax and Hong Kong minimum top-up tax. Let's invite representatives of the administration to come inside the conference room. Public officers in attendance today are Mr. Maurice Liu, Deputy Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury, Treasury 2, Mr. Stephen Lowe, Principal Assistant Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury, Treasury R2, Mr. Tam Tai Peng, Commissioner of Inland Revenue, Mr. Benjamin Chen, Deputy Commissioner Technical of Inland Revenue, and Ms. Florence Lam, Assistant Commissioner, International and Taxation Development, Acting Inland Revenue Department. Thank you. Welcome, representatives of the administration. Mr. Maurice Liu will first give a brief opening remark. Well, I'll let the Commissioner of Inland Revenue, Mr. Tam, give a short presentation. We plan to introduce the top-up tax as well as the some tax administration measures. In July 2021, the OECD announced the international tax reform framework of a two-pillar solution to tackle the base erosion and profit-shifting BAPS risks arising from digitalization of economy, known as BAPS 2.0. Pillar 2 involves the vicious competition between jurisdictions to create a more level playing field in terms of taxation. The Pillar 2 involves the implementation of a global minimum tax on M&E groups with annual consolidated revenue of Euro 750 million or above. It does not affect the smaller enterprises. So the policy intent is that if the effective tax rate is lower than 15%, enterprises would have to pay a top-up tax. We have a profits tax rate of 16.5%, but we have exempted most foreign income as well as capital gains as well as dividends. So the accounting profit may be $100 million. With the tax exemptions, they only have paid taxes amounting to tens of millions in Hong Kong, for example, 50 million. So it may amount to just 10% tax rate, effective tax rate of their revenue. So who can charge the top-up tax according to the OECD? They have the globe rules, global anti-base erosion rules. They have the income inclusion rule, IRR, and the under tax profits rule, UTPR. How do they work? For example, for an M&E group that is headquartered in the UK, for the constituent entities in Hong Kong, if they pay an effective tax rate of lower than 15%, for example, 10%, they will need to pay 5% in top-up tax. The UK can then charge the headquarter, the parent entity in the UK, 5% top-up tax. For a company that is headquartered in somewhere else that does not have globe rules covered, other jurisdictions may charge this top-up tax. That is, other jurisdictions that would have their constituent entities operating in such jurisdictions, as long as the jurisdictions are covered by globe rules. And with this UTPR, they can charge the top-up tax in 5%, for example, for these M&A groups that have to pay such top-up tax, it would be charged based on the tangible assets and the number of employees that they have in the jurisdiction. Even if the jurisdiction that has the lower effective tax rate that won't charge the top-up tax, other jurisdictions can charge the top-up tax. That is, if we do not implement such rules, the MNE group would still have to pay the same amount of taxes. It's just a matter of where the taxes is to be paid to. Regarding IIR and UTPR, they expect jurisdictions to introduce a qualified domestic minimum top-up tax, and we will have a Hong Kong minimum top-up tax. For example, if we are to charge the top-up tax in 5%, as said in the previous example, we will have tax arrangements that would charge the 5% top-up tax, and other jurisdictions won't be able to quote the globe rules to charge the top-up tax. That is what we want to do in the proposed legislative amendments. We have conducted a three-month consultation starting from 21st of December 2023 to the 20th of March of this year. As a minimum tax rate of 50% is required, the tax competitiveness would rely on how the jurisdiction could minimize compliance burden on MNE groups rather than charging a low tax rate. Hong Kong will attempt to implement and administer the globe rules in a way that would minimize the compliance burden on MNE groups so as to enhance our competitiveness. I will talk about it in detail later. Let's talk about the second part of the legislative amendments. We would require MNE enterprises to do mandatory e-filing of profits tax returns. The Inland Revenue Amendment Miscellaneous Provisions Ordinance 2021 was enacted in 2021 to have the Commissioner of Inland Revenue empowered to, by notice published in the Gazette, require taxpayers to furnish their profits tax returns in the form of an electronic record. We had first allowed businesses to voluntarily e-file profits tax returns, including financial statements, in 2023. We have now allowed enterprises to submit more forms of financial statements to the IRD for proof. This is essentially a trial arrangement, testing out whether we can implement mandatory e-filing. In fact, some enterprises proposed to join the scheme themselves to facilitate their filing. Under our current proposal for legislative amendments, in-scope and NE groups will need to file their top-up tax returns electronically for an accounting period beginning on or after 1st of January 2025. So be in scope and NE groups would be, as we said, M&E groups with an annual consolidated revenue of 750 million or above euros. As this is a year from now, we believe the M&E groups would be able to be familiar with the e-filing of tax-related documents. And in fact, OECD required the submission of certain financial reports by M&E groups. We believe it is therefore appropriate to mandate e-filing of returns and financial statements by in-scope M&E groups. That's it for my report. Thank you. We will set the time limit to be 4 minutes, questions and answers included. First, Mr. Rock Chen. I would like to thank the administration for arranging meetings with council members to brief members on the proposal and answer members' questions. This is very efficient and I do appreciate it. And I would like to clarify two things. With the legislative amendments implemented, some foreign enterprises that have subsidiaries in Hong Kong, they would perhaps, for financial enterprises, they would operate funds that may operate globally, even if they operate those funds in Hong Kong. Their revenue would, of course, have to be included in the charging of global minimum tax. But then, as I said, the funds would have products from elsewhere. Would their revenue be included in the Hong Kong subsidiaries' revenue? I think it may not be counted, but I just want a clarification from the administration. I understand that there are a number of in-scope M&E groups in Hong Kong. Will you provide briefings or training sessions for the 100-odd in-scope M&E groups so that their accountants or staff members will know about the legislative amendments and their implementation? Thank you.
Thank you. I'll take the second question first. As early as in 2000, the government set up an advisory panel tapping the pulse of the industry and so on. We've been holding discussions with the relevant stakeholders. After publishing the consultation documents, we've been in touch with mega enterprises, representatives of chambers of commerce, the accounting sector, different professionals. We've been exchanging views with them. We also brief them on the implementation details. When the legislation takes effect, we'll continue to maintain liaison with the industry. We'll take on board their recommendations in order to have a smooth implementation in the future. There will also be detailed guidelines, explanations, FAQs, demonstrations and so on. There will also be colleagues answering questions from members of the public. Simply put, we'll still work on helping the industry or helping the people that will be affected as a result by the legislative amendment exercise. Regarding funds, I will invite Mr. Benjamin Chan to answer this question. Regarding funds or for investment entities, first of all, in accordance with GLOBE rules, with the OECD, if the fund itself is an ultimate parent entity, basically it will not be subject to the rule. That is, it will not be covered by the rule. for entities under it, well, it depends on whether a consolidated financial statement will be required. So in most cases, it will not be covered. Under the rules, there will also be special clauses requesting investment entities the taxes will not be covered by the fund. Instead, it will fall into the company. That will also reduce the compliance costs of some entities. Next, Mr. Bill Tang. Thank you, Chairman. Regarding the implementation of the global minimum tax and Hong Kong minimum top-up tax, after hearing from the officials, well, I think it will definitely be good to Hong Kong. The pros definitely outweigh the cons. And there will also be a positive impact on the tax revenue to Hong Kong, generating over $10 billion. Well, I can see at least two benefits. First of all, on increasing the tax revenue or enhancing the appeal of Hong Kong for enterprises headquartered in Hong Kong, they can do the mass and they can reap the benefits. This is the first benefit. Using ultra-low tax to attract Hong Kong to headquarter or to be headquartered in those jurisdictions, well, they can actually leave those islands, so to speak. They can come to Hong Kong. These are the benefits as I can understand. There will also be an increase in the tax revenue by $10 billion. What is the basis of this amount? What are the premises? How did you arrive at this amount? Commissioner. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Member. Actually, our estimate is premised on the fact that some companies have to file some reports to us, that is in other jurisdictions all over the world. The operation details, such as the size of their company, in which jurisdictions they operate, then we have estimates. That is, after the implementation of the top-up tax regime, how much top-up tax we can receive. Well, in other words, you mean you obtain the figure with the company that has an annual consolidated revenue of 750 million euro dollars. Is that correct? Well, according to the reports we receive and the information that can be reflected in the reports, after the rollout of the scheme, will there be any changes to the operational details, the economic situation? Well, it's of course quite difficult for us to take into account all these factors. Well, your estimate is not very aggressive in your information paper. You only base the estimate on your, on the existing situation. Well, put it this way. We based on the historical data or the information we have at that time. So if it will be a benefit to Hong Kong, I hope that the administration will also step up international publicity, and in due course, I hope the administration will come back to Let's Go to let us know what enterprises have come to Hong Kong as a result of this new minimum top-up tax regime. Ms. Carmen Khan, thank you, Chairman. I speak in support of the legislative exercise, and that is the implementation of the global minimum tax and Hong Kong minimum top-up tax. The reasons are simple. As mentioned in the PowerPoint slides, it can protect the tax right of Hong Kong. In other words, if we do not put in place this tax regime, we may lose some companies out to other jurisdictions. But of course, it's equally important to explain to the potential companies. For companies headquartered in overseas jurisdictions or for in-scope companies, we do need to let these companies know that when they pay tax to Hong Kong, that will not affect the amount of the tax that they will have to pay. They are actually going to pay the same amount anyway. Regarding the timeline of China to implement the minimum top-up tax, well, it's likely that for Hong Kong companies, we may have entities in mainland China, or the in-scope companies may not be headquartered in Hong Kong, so I'd like to know the timetable. On a different note, China also has a redomiciliation regime that is to provide convenience to businesses for them to redomicile in Hong Kong. This will also help them with their corporate structure in order to protect the taxation right of Hong Kong. So, this will not be an additional tax burden on these companies. Just now, we mentioned a blacklist or a grey list of the OECD. That is different. We need a peer review. When does it have to be implemented? Can the legislative amendment exercise work with that? Well, thank you. China has not yet announced any timetable for the globe rules regarding the redomiciliation system. Yes, indeed. While studying the implementation of the Hong Kong minimum top-up tax, we noticed some corporates, owing to taxing concerns, may consider setting up companies or holding companies in other jurisdictions. When we have the minimum top-up tax in Hong Kong, when these companies set up companies in Hong Kong, they will not be able to avoid paying tax. This way, we may make these companies rethink whether they will restructure their corporate structure. So for companies set up in low tax or no tax jurisdictions, they may be willing to move their companies back to Hong Kong. So with the new redomiciliation system, some companies are allowed to move their companies back into Hong Kong. Redomiciliation is possible. Regarding the peer review, under globe rules, there are several rules. As I mentioned, there are UDPR, there is IIR, or the minimum Hong Kong top-up tax. All these need to become qualified IIR and qualified UDPR. Only when they become qualified will the OECD recognize all these rules. In other words, when we collect taxes under IIR and UDPR, when these are not qualified tax payments, these tax payments will not be recognized by the OECD. Then these taxes will have to be calculated from scratch. Like Hong Kong top-up tax, the soon-to-be-implemented peer review will operate in these jurisdictions. That is whether these rules are qualified rules. Regarding the peer review, it is still being developed. Thank you. Well, I have to draw a line. Four members to go. Next, Mr. Chan Kim Po.
Thank you, Chairman.
It's something good. In my previous exchanges with the Inland Revenue Department, officials did a great job. They provide great support to us, such as streamlining different procedures, explaining different policies to us. Ideally, according to statistics, we have a general picture of the situation, but is it possible? Well, I mean, why more companies would come to Hong Kong than the companies that would leave Hong Kong? It will be dated back to the 1st of January. Yes, it can include the retrospective effect. It is important whether it is a recognized or a qualified rule. So, it's the scheme sustainable in the worst-case scenario when many people or companies leave? What measures do you have accordingly? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Member. The first question is about the reason why we believe the companies will not leave Hong Kong. Simply put, there are many jurisdictions where these top-up tax regimes have already been in place. They implemented this regime even earlier than we will. In probably Europe, Asia-Pacific, these rules are in place as well. That is, wherever their companies will move to, they will also be subject to this set of minimum top-up tax rule. It's applicable whether to Hong Kong or other jurisdictions. These companies are still subject to the same rule. Some jurisdictions may not charge any tax or just a very low tax to attract different companies to go over to these jurisdictions. But then, this trick will not work wonders in the future. This will provide a level playing field for companies around the world. After all, in Hong Kong still charges a low tax rate. And the tax regime in Hong Kong is still simple. Comparing with other jurisdictions, Hong Kong still has a great appeal. Of course, we also boast other advantages that are not related to tax, and I'm not going to dig deep into these areas. Simply put, I think that we will be able to maintain our competitive edge. In the future, when the regime is put in place, the compliance burden will be minimized. That is, when we implement the Hong Kong minimum top-up tax, we'll make sure it will be well within the OECD requirements. Hence, there will be a safety harbor. For multinational companies, when they are set up or when they set up subsidiaries in Hong Kong, they will not have to calculate the tax from scratch once again in the filing of tax returns and notifications or notices. We'll try to streamline the procedures and we'll also provide more support. In this connection, we can enhance our tax competitive edge. On the retrospective period, that is the 1st of January 2024, basically, that is about the retrospective period of the definition of Hong Kong residents. Some jurisdictions have already put in place this minimum top-up tax regime. And we'll have to see in which jurisdiction the company is a tax resident. We do not want the definition to change this fact. So, we'd like to have a definition of tax residence. That is why we need to introduce a retrospective period of the 1st of January 2024, so the subsidiaries of these multinational companies will not be considered the residents of other jurisdictions. And the lowest tax rate will be calculated from the year of assessment 2025. I'll have to extend the meeting by 15 minutes. Next member, Dr. Wendy Hong. Thank you, Chairman. I speak in support of the implementation of the global minimum tax and Hong Kong minimum top-up tax.
Most of my questions have already been answered by the administration. I just have one more question. Once the implementation of global minimum tax is in place, does it mean that while we want to attract some Mac enterprises, some preferential tax regimes will not work wonders? They will not be effective. So do we need to roll out other measures in order to attract other Mac enterprises from around the world to come to Hong Kong? After introducing the global minimum tax, regarding the impact on different taxes, the situation will vary from one to another. Some companies enjoy lower tax rates if they do not make up for a large portion of the business of the mega enterprises in Hong Kong. Their impact will not be too much for these companies. On a different note, on calculating the actual tax rate, there is a calculation method. The income tax, the income will have to deduct the asset and expenses on staff members. Hence, the amount on profits will be lower. In the end, the actual tax rate will be boosted. Many preferential tax regimes also request the companies in Hong Kong to have actual business activities. This will reduce impact on the minimum tax in Hong Kong. Of course, the government will also have other measures to attract these large-scale companies to establish presence in Hong Kong. Next, Deputy Chair Dr. So Cheng Wing. Thank you, Chairman. Some 10 billion revenue may be brought to Hong Kong. I'd like to know the basis of your estimate. I'd also like to know the proportion of foreign-owned, state-owned, China-owned, or Chinese-invested companies. I'd like to know these proportions. Just now, the officials said that they are very confident that Hong Kong will not lose some enterprises out to other competitors. But likewise, Singapore is also going to put in place the minimum tax of 15% in 2025. There are much controversies surrounding Singapore. Despite the increase in tax revenue, the administration may scare away some companies and may lose some companies out to Singapore. So what is the difference of our policies comparing with Singapore's? Thank you.
Let me stress that the global rules will be implemented internationally. In our point of view, even when the MNE group move to another jurisdiction, the impact would be the same. True, the sector has told the government their worries during the consultation process. But we think in order to comply with the OECD requirements, we have to implement the rules. But we will try to facilitate local businesses as well as MNE groups to comply with the requirements. Our tax environment will continue to be competitive. We are not worried that the MNE groups will leave Hong Kong simply because of the 15% global minimum tax rate. Concerning the breakdown of our additional tax revenue, I don't have the information yet, and we will supplement the data after the meeting. The last member, Mr. Sunny Tang. Thank you, Chairman. I'm in support of this legislative proposal. BEPS 2.0 was discussed by a task force under the Financial Secretary's office a few years ago. Now, with the implementation of this rule, we can ensure that M&E groups with a threshold above 750 million euros will be subject to tax. They will need to conduct tax planning, and through this opportunity, we can attract more M&E groups to Hong Kong. Now, there is the dedicated assistance offered by the IRD to taxpayers. Now, can the Secretary discuss with the Financial Secretary Office to offer something more than assistance? But helps with real substance to move their substantial activities to Hong Kong so as to balance, so as to even out the potential additional cost on tax. So in this regard, have the Invest Hong Kong and the OASIS discussed how we can offer more help to foreign companies? Now, are there additional preferential tax measures offered to major companies besides that BEPS 2.0? Secretary? Thank you. Dedicated assistance refers to facilitation in tax assessment by the IRD. Supports would be given to corporations on tax assessment as well as other inquiries. On policy matters, including attracting more major enterprises to Hong Kong besides tax attractions, I think the Financial Secretary is doing a lot of work in this regard, but this is not my purview. Mr. Stephen Lo, as mentioned by Mr. Chen, the Financial Secretary's office as well as this bureau have assessed the impact brought about by the implementation of BEPS 2.0. We know that the Invest Hong Kong will conduct publicity concerning the changes in taxation. So we will make sure that we brief our colleagues properly so that they can properly explain to the outreaching targets on the impact of this change. And also, we are continuously inviting new ideas on how to better facilitate investment in Hong Kong. And 2 years ago, we had the OASIS. So after the implementation of BEPS, there would be a fairer operating environments for all business. So how can we attract major enterprises to come? And we will have to think about measures other than taxation. Thank you. I hope the government would really take stock of the impact of BEPS 2.0. Now, for major enterprises, that taxation strategy will not easily change. But this time, they have to change. So this should be an opportunity for us. We should strike out and reach out to these major enterprises because our competitor will do the same. Now, according to the government's plan, in the first half of 2024, the government will submit the relevant amendments to the subsidiary legislation concerning mandatory electronic tax return filing. And in the second half of the year, this amendments will be submitted to the Council. So I think most members supported the legislative timetable. Now, item 7, AOB. If there is no AOB, this meeting is adjourned. Thank you.